Heavenly Father, we are thankful for all the blessings we have received, and our hearts are open and asking for more. We pray you'll pour into us more knowledge, more wisdom, more truth, more love and goodness, more the fruit of your Spirit, as Rhina shared with us earlier in the story. And just bless us now as we wait upon you. In Jesus' name, amen. Has anybody seen this advertisement for this movie? Some of you have. You know, with the modern miracle of computer algorithms, this one has brought to my attention as something that I might want to watch from time to time. Heaven is for real. I did some research into this particular film. It was produced back in 2014, so that's about 9 years ago. It was a controversial Christian movie when it was made. It's the story of a four-year-old boy who visited heaven in what was called a near-death experience, leaving his family to wrestle with the impact of what he experienced and its spiritual implications. I understand that his father was a pastor at the time. Now, critics of the film cited problems in its depiction of heaven that many thought were not biblical. But despite the controversy, people flocked out to the theaters to view the movie. It debuted at number 2, and it grossed $52 million in its first 3 weeks alone. So it was very popular, widely viewed. The backstory was Colton Burpo had an emergency appendectomy and nearly died at 4 years old. So he was on Camden's age, 4 years old, emergency appendectomy, kind of unusual. And after the surgery, he began to recall things that had happened to him during the surgery. He said that he saw his older sister, which, interestingly, had been miscarried by his mother years before. He said that he saw his great-grandfather, whom he'd never met in real life. Said he saw Jesus in heaven, saw John the Baptist there, saw bright colors and rainbows, and said that while he was in surgery, he had seen his mother praying and his father yelling at God, both of which happened to be true. And so Colton's family had to deal with the account of his experience, but with the book and then the movie coming out, there were millions of other people who had to deal with Colton's account of what happened. And we have to deal with his account as well. And we'll have to deal with other accounts that will be coming because near-death experiences, NDEs as they're commonly called, are getting more and more common, coining the term and actually a film genre of its own called heavenly tourism. And so heavenly tourism genre of films are depictions of people who have died or had near-death experiences, gone to heaven, and then came back with reports. Alex Malarkey, and yes, ironically, that is his last name, was the subject of a film called The Boy Who Came Back from Heaven. But his experience at 6 years old when he had a tragic car accident with his father that led to his account when he was 6 years old, then he later retracted his story as an embellished, complete fabrication. Here's what Alex said. Quote, "I did not die. I did not go to heaven. I said I went to heaven because I thought it would get me attention. When I made the claims that I did, I had never read the Bible." And he said, "People have profited from lies and continue to. They should read the Bible, which is enough." End of quote. Well, against the backdrop of Alex Malarkey's recantation, Colton Burpo continued to stand by his account of going to heaven as completely factual, accurate, and true. Well, I just want to say today that every so-called trip to heaven is either true or false. It's either from God or it's not. It's either supported by Scripture or contradicts the Word of God. One writer said this, quote, "Stories like Colton's fascinate people with spiritual interest because it is not possible to prove or disprove their veracity." Now, I wouldn't agree with that, would you? Is it impossible to prove or disprove the truthfulness of these accounts? Well, he says, the fact of the matter is that whether or not moviegoers believe the authenticity of the story, they are heading out to see the film in droves. And so millions of people are going in curiosity and interest to watch these movies and films, wanting to know, of course, about heaven and what happens when you die and so forth. So on our part as Christians, we are faced with the responsibility of applying Scripture to every such account that might come. The Bible says, do not despise prophesying. It says, prove all things, though, and then hold fast to that which is good. And so I want to try to do that together today. Prove all things, and then hold on to what is good. Now, one thing the Bible tells us is that Satan was once in heaven. Is that right? And so he has seen heaven. He has experienced life in heaven. He knows some things about heaven. And I would argue that he uses what he knows about heaven to deceive people on earth. Because deception always, always involves parts that are very much true. We know that Satan began his campaign in heaven to be worshipped. He began that campaign with deception, and his deceptive arts were so wily that he led a third of the angels astray. And according to Revelation, we know that he'll end his campaign for worship with deception, this time deceiving apparently the whole world. Now, the first deception recorded in the Bible taking place on earth is found in Genesis chapter 3. Let's read it again. The serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field that the Lord God had made, and he said to the woman, "Has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden?" And the woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die." And then the serpent said to the woman, "You will not surely die, for God knows in the day that you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you'll be like God, knowing good and evil." Now, it's interesting that Eve knew nothing at this point about death. She'd never seen death. She'd never experienced death. She knew nothing about death. It was a complete mystery to her. And so Satan shows up to explain to Eve in the garden what death really is. And he essentially says that death is actually the doorway to another life, a life where you are more like God, a life where you know things that you are not privy to know here on earth. In other words, death isn't really death, it's really eternal life. It's not an enemy to be feared, but it is a friend to be welcomed, that death is some sort of friendly carriage that you get on, and then it carries you above the earthbound limitations of humanity in this world. And since sin precedes death, sin then becomes desirable as the necessary prerequisite to get on board that chariot, that ticket to ride, and then you know things that you couldn't know otherwise. So it's not really, as God said, sin and die, it's sin and live. And what a convenient deception, a false gospel, fake good news, if you will. And it's all based on the argument that the human soul is actually immortal. The idea that once it's created, the human soul can never cease to exist. It's immortal by nature. Now, that's a popular sermon that Satan has been preaching through various instruments since the Garden of Eden. that the soul is immortal and it simply cannot die. What does the Bible say? Ezekiel 18:4 says, the soul that sins, it will what? It will die. 1 Timothy 6:16 says that only God has immortality. 1 Corinthians 15, Paul said, this mortal must put on immortality. And then he says in Romans 2:7, to them who by patient continuance in well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality, eternal life. And so the Bible presents immortality as something that we don't possess by nature, but something that we have to seek after, that we must at some point put on the immortality that we do not have inherently. There are 1,500 references to the soul in Scripture. But of the 1,500 references that use the word soul in the King James Bible, never once is the adjective immortal ever attached to the human soul. Never once in 1,500 references. Well, given all that, you might ask, well, why is the doctrine of the immortal soul so very important to Satan, the great deceiver? Why is it so important to him? Well, think about it. If the soul cannot die and the punishment for sin is hellfire, then what do you have? Well, then you have God burning souls, immortal souls, in hell forever and ever without end. You have essentially infinite punishing for finite crimes. And that creates a picture of God as an unjust judge, a cruel tyrant, actually, a fiendish sadist of some kind, who delights in human suffering so much that he'll never bring it to an end for all of eternity. Now, why would Satan want God to be viewed like that? Why would he want God to be viewed like that? Well, clearly, wouldn't that justify his own rebellion in heaven? Presenting himself as the one who was wronged for being thrown out of heaven because he would not submit to such a tyrannical being as that. Now, many people reject eternal torment in hell, and rightly so. It just doesn't make sense to them that a God of love could possibly do that, and so they reject that idea, reject that teaching. But they continue to still believe in the immortal soul, so what other option do you have? If the soul is immortal, and you don't want to believe that God tortures people in hell for eternity, what other option do you have? If you can't put the immortal soul in hell, where else do you have to put it? You'd have to put it in heaven, right? And so now we are literally singing, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. But would it be a day of rejoicing if we all went to heaven? Unrepentant murderers, adulterers, thieves, and liars in heaven, just like the righteous? Selfish, sensual, irreligious people going to heaven, just like the committed saints of God? The hymn goes on to say, when we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the what? The victory. The victory over what? If everybody was there, it certainly would be victory over sin. And then you ask, well, if death is the fastest way to eternal life, who would want to wait to die? Why not end your life sooner and bypass all the pain and suffering that's associated with life as human beings in this sin-cursed world? And many people have made that choice and taken that option and ended their own lives, unfortunately, deceived. Now, if you say the soul is immortal, then you really only have these two alternatives, don't you? If you say the soul is immortal, then you either have God torturing sinners in hell, how long? For eternity, which would actually be a hyper extension of justice, more justice than is really do. Or the other alternative is you have everyone with eternal life in heaven, a hyperextension of grace and mercy, and an abuse, actually, of the grace of God. Now, the Catholic Church, to deal with these two problems, came up with something called purgatory, where you basically spend some time in hell, but then you move on, ultimately, to heaven. Is that in the Bible? No, of course not. But neither are those two alternatives that made purgatory necessary in the eyes of the Church of Rome. Thankfully, there are two biblical alternatives. Here they are. One, the Bible says the wages of sin is what? Death, Romans 6:23. But the other alternative says the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord at his what? At his coming. These are the two alternatives the Bible presents. The wages of sin is death, and then the gift of God, that is eternal life through Jesus at his coming. So we could say that heaven is for real. Amen? Hey, is heaven for real? Yes. Is hell for real? Yes? Okay. But heaven is for those who love God and hate sin. And hell is for those that love sin and hate God and his law, and have unfit themselves through their hatred of God and his law to actually have eternity in heaven. Now, as far as the lost, what does the Bible say? In Psalm 37:20, the psalmist says, the wicked shall what? Perish, cease to exist. Into smoke, it says, they will consume away. Psalm 37:10, yet a little while, and the wicked shall not be. Yea, thou shalt diligently consider his place, and it shall not be. Malachi 4, verse 1, the day that's coming, future, will burn them up, says the Lord of hosts, and leave them neither root nor branch. And so that is describing the complete annihilation of the wicked. It goes on to say they'll be turned into ashes, it says in Malachi chapter 4 and verse 3. And finally, Obadiah 1:16 describes them as they will be as though they had not been. Now that's pretty clear, isn't it? It's talking about a complete ceasing to exist, so much so that it will be as though they actually had not been. Now more and more Christians are coming to accept that the souls of the wicked do in fact die, perish, cease to exist. I could name a few. John Stott, a famous theologian from England, I believe. Philip Hughes, Clark Pinnock, John Wenham, John Gerstner, Edward Fudge, and I could probably name others as well. People who have studied the Bible carefully and come to the conclusion, different than they formerly believed, that yes, hell is something that completely destroys the wicked. So thinking people are coming to understand that souls are not immortal by nature. But now, what about the righteous? What about the people who actually will live forever? When does eternal life begin for them? Do they go to heaven immediately when they die? Well, the Bible says no. And for several reasons. Number one, there has to be a judgment first, which the Bible clearly says in prophecy is going on now as I speak. Revelation 14 says, the hour of his judgment has come. So the judgment begins and goes on, even as the gospel is going out to the whole world there in Revelation 14. So there has to be a judgment first, and it's going on now. In Revelation 22:11, there is coming a time when God will look down and say, he that is unjust, let him be unjust still. He that's filthy, let him be filthy still. He that is righteous, let him be righteous still. He that is holy, let him be holy still. Now, my friends, that is the end of the judgment. Every case has been decided. Every decision has been made. God realizes nobody's going to change sides, and he declares it over. And then the very next verse, it says, behold, I am what? coming quickly, and my reward is with me to give to everyone according to his work. Think about it. Would it be logical for someone to live and die, and you put them in heaven for hundreds of years, and then you take them out of heaven and say, well, I guess we better have a judgment to decide whether they belong in heaven or not? Would that make sense? Would it make sense to put someone in hell for hundreds of years and then say, oh, wait, let's have a judgment to figure out if they belong there? No, even, of course, our own system of incomplete justice that we have, we recognize that the judgment comes first and then the reward or punishment. And so the judgment will conclude prior to Jesus' return, and then he comes with his reward. Number two, according to the Bible, the dead are not actually allowed to see or be involved in the lives of the living. How do we know that? Psalm 146:4 says, his breath goes forth, he returns to his earth. In that very day, what happens to his thoughts? They perish. So are dead people thinking about the living? No, they're not. In fact, it says here in Ecclesiastes 9, 5, and 6, the living, they know that they will die, but the dead, they know not anything. Their love, their hatred, their envy is now, what's the word again? Perished, neither have they any more portion forever in anything that is done under the sun. So no, the dead are not involved in the lives of the living. In verse 10 of Ecclesiastes 9, it says, there's no work or device or knowledge nor wisdom in the grave whither thou goest. Psalm 6, verse 5, in death there is no remembrance of thee. In the grave who shall give thee thanks? The dead praise not the Lord, neither any that go down into silence. All right? So there has to be a judgment first, and the dead are not involved in the living and the life on earth and what's going on here under the sun. And number three, there must be a resurrection from the dead prior to anyone receiving eternal life. How do we know that? Well, Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, 16 to 18, if the dead do not rise, Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins, Paul says. And then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have what, friends? Perish. So Paul's telling us here, look, the resurrection of the body is so critical, it's so important, that if there's no resurrection of the body, then those who've fallen asleep, the common word the Bible uses for death, they have what? Perished. That's the end of their existence if there's no resurrection of the body. All right. Now, what about the movie? Getting back to Heaven is for Real, what's wrong with the movie Heaven is for Real? Or we might ask, what would make the movie right? Well, I guess if the only takeaway from the movie was that heaven is a real place, then that would be good. Because it is. There is really a place called heaven. Isaiah saw it. Ezekiel saw it. John saw it. Paul saw it. Heaven is for real. And those that end up in heaven, they're going to see Jesus. Amen? Is it going to be a day of rejoicing? Are we going to sing and shout the victory? We'll see Jesus. We'll see God. We'll see the angels. You'll see Bible characters. You'll see friends and loved ones that are saved. And yes, you'll see a rainbow and brilliant, dazzling colors and delightful things that Paul said, eye has not seen or ear heard. It isn't even entered in the heart of man, the things that God has prepared for those that love him in heaven. But to be biblically accurate, the movie, Heaven is for Real, was really lacking something critical. What was it lacking? Well, there was no call in the movie to repentance of sin. There was no call for confession of sin. There was no call to submit to Jesus as Lord of your life and place your faith in him as a personal Savior. There was no call to preparation for the coming of Christ. At the end of time, there was no urgent call to spiritual revival and moral reform. Now, It's interesting that Alex Malarkey, who I quoted earlier, this is the boy that at 6 years old told the story that he later admitted that he made up, and he's been trying to make up for what he said ever since by warning people about what the Bible really says. And he says here, it is only through repentance of your sins and a belief in Jesus as the Son of God who died for your sins so that you can be forgiven. And he says, I want the whole world to know that the Bible is sufficient, and those who market these materials must be called to repent and hold the Bible as enough. End of quote. And so I say, well, good for him. He's doing what he can to direct people to the Bible rather than esoteric accounts of things that people claim to have experienced. But Colton Burpo's account lacks the characteristics of a prophetic vision or a prophetic dream. In his account, there's no admonition, there's no warning, there's no charge, there's no exhortation, there's no rebuke of sin. And it's interesting when you contrast his experience with the Bible prophets. When Isaiah was taken off in vision and he saw God, what was his response? He said, woe is me, I am undone. I am a man of unclean lips. I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King. Bible accounts of people who saw Jesus in all his glory, their response was to fall as though dead and realize, like Daniel said, my comeliness was turned in me into corruption. Colton Burpo's reaction to heaven was to say, heaven is for real and you're going to like it. How different. I guess the most troubling thing about this movie would be its context, which was the context of having emergency surgery. Because it's really the experience of a person who is hovering near what? Hovering near death. And so the suggestion that runs through the story and others like it is that heaven is where you go immediately when you what? When you die. But that furthers the suggestion of the deception that death is the doorway to life. In a place where you know things. It's the exact same thing that Satan told Eve way back when. And so unsuspecting moviegoers might come away thinking that when people die, they do immediately go to heaven. No mention is given of any requirements for getting there in terms of repenting, believing in Jesus, surrendering to him, and accepting his salvation. So I know it's a heartwarming story, and that's why people like it, and it's comforting, and it's encouraging, and I understand that. But is this the comfort we're supposed to have according to the Bible? Listen to Paul. Paul says here, the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ will what? Rise first. That's the resurrection. Then we that are alive and remain are going to be caught up together with them, the resurrected ones, in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Friends, if we're ever going to be with the Lord, it's going to be through the coming of Jesus and a resurrection from the dead. Amen? And then Paul says, wherefore, comfort one another with what? These words. What words? Not the words of people that have had near-death experiences, but the words of the Apostle Paul. The Lord's coming back, a shout, a voice, a resurrection, a trumpet, and the dead in Christ will rise first. And then we'll always be with the Lord. So it is true that life follows death. Let me ask you, let me see if you agree. Do you believe that life follows death? And that we get to heaven by way of the grave? Is that true? Do we have to go to heaven by way of the grave? I mean, unless we're those that are alive and remain at the coming of Jesus. But if we're not, do we have to go to heaven by way of the grave? Okay, but that's only half the truth, right? The full truth is that we get to heaven by way of the grave, but only by the resurrection from the dead, And that is only through Jesus Christ, and that is only at his coming. Do you agree with that? Okay. So the movie kind of teaches a half-truth, not the whole truth. And I think that's the danger in it. And you think about this, like every other near-death experience, who gets cut out of the equation? Who is completely missing? Jesus, right? Because according to all these things people are saying, all you have to do is die and you go. But the Bible says that God has given Jesus uniquely the ability, the power to resurrect people. And without him, there's no way we can get to heaven, right? I mean, we cannot get from earth to heaven unless he personally comes back and resurrects us from the dead and takes us up in the clouds to meet him in the air. And apparently, Jesus was trying to get this point across to people in his time when he said, "Verily, verily, I say to you, the hour is coming," that's future, "and now is when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear will" what? The only way to live eternally is to hear his voice at his coming and come back to life. In John 14, 6, what did he say? "I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. Nobody comes to the Father but through me." In John 11, 25, "I am the resurrection and the life. He that believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live." And I like this one, Revelation 1 and verse 18, Jesus said, "I have the keys of the grave and of death." He likens the grave to a locked door that there's no way. The devil has, you know, because of sin, we all have to come under the power of death, and that power is in the hands of the devil. And we all have to come under the power of death, and we're locked in the grave, but thankfully, Jesus has the key to every grave, amen? And he alone can unlock it and resurrect people and bring them back to life and give them eternity with him. Now, before we close, we should answer this question. Are there any people that are alive in heaven right now? Now, it's interesting that the people that are alive in heaven right now, they are actually named by name in the Bible. So we know that Elijah's there, right? And we know that Enoch is there. And what do Elijah and Enoch both have in common? They never what? They never died, right? They were taken while they were living up to heaven. Elijah went up in a whirlwind. Enoch walked with God and God took him. These two men never died. Now, there's only one man we're told about in the Bible who did die and go to heaven. Who's that? You're right, Moses. How do we know Moses is there? Because you read in the Bible that Moses was appearing to Jesus with Elijah on the Mount of Transfiguration. So we know Moses is there. But the book of Jude alludes to the fact that before he went there, Moses was first what? Resurrected. You can read that in the book of Jude. The devil was contending over the body of Moses as the Lord was about to resurrect him. And so he was resurrected before he went up. But if you thought about this, there is no account of anyone in the Bible going straight to heaven when they died. Is there? Can you think of anybody? None. So I guess the closest thing to that would be the parable of the rich man and Lazarus. But do you read that parable in Luke 16? It doesn't say that Lazarus went to heaven. It says Lazarus went where? Abraham's bosom. Why would it say Abraham's bosom? Because everybody among the Jewish people believed that Abraham would be saved. And it's just the way of saying the Lazarus, the beggar, was going to be saved. He's going to be with Abraham. It doesn't say he went to heaven. And really, the story of the rich man and Lazarus is a story full of symbolism that has very little to do with death and everything to do with salvation. And do you remember in the parable, the rich man said to the Lord, "Send Lazarus to my brothers so they're not lost like I am." Remember that? And Jesus made it clear at the end of that parable that for Lazarus to go to his brothers, Lazarus would have to be what? Resurrected from the dead, because he said, they have Moses and the prophets. If they don't believe them, they won't even believe if one rose from the dead. So Jesus is very clear that nobody goes to heaven except through the resurrection. Is that clear? Now, what about absent from the body and present with the Lord? Does anybody know where that verse is found? Is there a verse in the Bible that says, absent from the body, present with the Lord? Is there? Does anybody know where it is? Well, it's actually in the writings of Paul. It's in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 1 to 8. And if you would take the time to read the context of Paul's statement in 2 Corinthians 5, 1 to 8 there, and then you couple that with all Paul's other letters, he argues clearly that you will be present with the Lord when you're absent from your body, but when you're present with the Lord and absent from your body, you'll be in his presence in a brand new what? A brand new body, which you will get at what event? At the coming of Christ and the resurrection of the dead, when Paul said, this mortal will put on immortality. This corruptible will put on incorruption. When will it happen? Paul said, at the last trump. The trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised. Now, I guess the most dangerous thing about this movie is that it sets people up to become victims of spiritualism. Now, what is spiritualism? Spiritualism is the teaching that the dead who are in heaven can come back to earth, involve themselves in the lives of the living, bringing messages, protecting them from danger and harm, offering comfort in sorrow, guidance in decisions, communicating with the living from the other side. That's spiritualism. Now, we know that evil angels are masters of deception. And one of the things that evil angels are able to do is they're able to personate dead people. How do we know that? Well, because it happens all the time. And it happened in the Bible, actually. Remember when King Saul went to visit the witch of Endor? And she conjured up a spirit. And what did the spirit look like? It looked like the prophet Samuel, sounded like Samuel, was so convincing that Saul really believed he was talking to Samuel. And the counterfeit is always perfect. A familiar appearance, familiar words, familiar tones, and memories of things that only loved ones and friends could possibly know. And that is a powerful combination, isn't it? I mean, you see somebody show up, looks like that person, sounds like that person, and knows things that only that person could possibly know. A powerful combination. And 4-year-old Colton Burpo said he saw his great-grandfather, and he talked with him. Said he saw his sister, older sister, whom his mother had miscarried years before. Said he had conversations with these people. What does the Bible say about talking to the dead? It condemns it outright, doesn't it? It calls it necromancy, and God calls that an abomination. And so think about it. This practice of talking to the dead is probably inadvertently and unintentionally. I'm not questioning the motives of anybody, but it's being foisted on the world oftentimes by Christians who are advocating this practice of talking to the dead. And people who believe in the immortal soul have no defense against spiritualism. And those who hold this belief will be prime targets for Satan's masterpiece of deception in the last days when the Bible says he is going to deceive the world. In Revelation chapter 16, John said, I saw three unclean spirits like frogs come out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. They are the spirits of devils. And what did John see them doing? Working miracles. Going out to the kings of the earth, political leaders, and the whole world, gathering them to the battle of the great day of God Almighty. Now, I take that verse there to mean that spiritualism, friends, is going to be coming at us from every direction. It's going to be coming from every religion. It's going to be coming from every corner of the world. We are going to see miracles being worked by devils and demonic spirits that are going to sweep the world unawares into the greatest deception the world has ever seen. So my question is, are we ready for that? Are we ready for that? You know, up to this point, the devil's had a leash on him. The Spirit of God has been restraining him, but there's coming a time when God's going to take off that restraint, and the devil's going to be let loose. And Jesus said they're going to show great signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, even the very elect. God help us. And so I'll leave you with this question. Is heaven for real? Come on, saints, is heaven for real?
Yes.
But I would say this movie isn't. Not according to the Word of God. And let's just circle back to our scripture reading that Tuma read earlier. It says, Isaiah 8, should they seek the dead on behalf of the living? What's God's answer? To the law and to the testimony, the Bible. If they don't speak according to this word, how much light? There's no light in them. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the Bible. It says the entrance of your word gives light. And the world, Lord, is shrouded in darkness. It's been under the control of the prince of darkness since the fall of Adam and Eve. And we're looking back today at the first great deception was this deception about the immortality of the soul. And that is an idea and a concept, Lord, that has gained great traction in our world, and we're seeing the fruit of it today. We just pray, Lord, that you'll help us always be biblical in our analysis of accounts and testimonies and stories. No matter how interesting they may appear or how much they may pique curiosity, we pray that we'll be grounded in truth, that we'll stand on the scriptures and what they say. And most of all today, Lord, we pray and we're thankful for the blessed hope of the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who will descend from heaven one day with a shout, the voice of the archangel, the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. And then we that are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord up in the air, and so shall we always be with the Lord. Help us take comfort in those words. Help us comfort others with those words. And Lord, may we do what we can to instill faith and trust in the scriptures in these last days. Save us, Lord. Save us from Satan. Save us from ourselves. Save us from every deception that's coming. We ask and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing number 442 in closing as we stand. How sweet are the tidings. Good old early Advent hymn about the return of Jesus. Number 442. Yes, he's coming, coming soon, I know, coming back to the earth again, and the weary pilgrims will to glory go when the Savior comes to reign. Lord, seal those words in our hearts today and always. May we ever be mindful and looking for your coming. And remember us, Lord, when you come in your kingdom, is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.
From generation to generation, passed down through every age, there's a story of a Savior whose love will never change. All creation will bow before him, every tongue will praise his name. Until the day he comes again, we will say, you are worthy.